Everybody, welcome back to the channel. I'm Robbie Cricker, the Flip Flop Flipper, and I'm here with Jennifer. What do you prefer?
Either or. Jennifer's fine.
And Jennifer has an amazing company, Finish Line TC Services. And I didn't know what TC stood for as I watched her speak over the weekend, but I learned that that's Transaction Coordinator. And guys, I've been in this business for a long time, and when you go to a conference, you look for one thing that you can take away from it that's going to help you to propel your business. And for me, having no idea that you were going to be there talking about Finish Line and about transaction coordination, it was an aha moment. So it was pretty cool. And so let's just talk about what you do as a transaction coordinator and who do you work for and that kind of stuff. And please, before we get into that, introduce yourself better than I just did. I'm sorry.
No worries. Thank you so much for having me. So Jennifer Cortez, I'm the CEO and co-founder of Finish Line TC Services. We handle transactions in all 50 states, including Puerto Rico. And don't feel bad because honestly, I didn't know what a transaction coordinator was before like sub two. I just knew that I wanted to get into the real estate business with my husband and I wanted to help him out. I just didn't know what.
Where do you fit in? How do you do that?
I didn't know that there's so many different things that you can do within real estate. Like all I knew was buyer, seller, real estate agent.
Yeah.
That's it.
That's and maybe mortgage broker. Those are the things that people know about real estate. And if you don't fit in one of these boxes, then you don't fit into real estate. And real estate investing is almost exclusively outside of the box, right? Like that's what's so beautiful about the business that we're in. And so you've started a business that goes alongside your other, so you and your husband have another business where you buy houses sub two, and then you have the Finish Line. So what does a transaction coordinator do?
Yeah, so we're the glue to the transaction. Right. Mm-hmm. We're the glue, we're the engine that just keeps the deal moving forward. So there are many real estate investors that want to do multiple deals at the same time. But how can you do that and scale your business at the same time? Right. Yeah. You have to follow up with attorneys. And if you've worked with attorneys many, many times, right, sometimes they're pretty slow at getting back to you. Right. And it gets frustrating having to do that over and over and over again and keeping track, you know, every step of the way for every deal. Because when you're working on deals, you start one today, next week you start another one, and they're at different stages throughout time, right? So a transaction coordinator is coming in and taking the deal from contract to close. Mm-hmm. And you, as the real estate investor, can continue to, you know, search for more deals because that's what you guys are good at, right? Just like my husband, he's phenomenal at that, and I'm phenomenal at the paperwork.
Yeah. And so if I'm in acquisitions, I can hand it to you to get me from contract to closing on the buy. And if I've done the value add real estate investing and now I'm selling it, I'm going to hand it back to you again to get my buyer across the finish line and close that transaction, which both are equally important and both free up myself the time that you're talking about so that I can go on to the next thing, whatever that is, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And I know that you've mentioned like you didn't hear what a transaction coordinator was before. So on average, you know, we're alleviating 10 to 15 hours per file for investors, right? Yeah. So imagine how many new connections you can make during that time, how many new deals you can lock up during that time.
Right?
Like one deal, one wholesale deal on average is about 10 to 15 grand. Sometimes more, sometimes a little bit less, but that's about average, right? So imagine the amount of money that we are actually putting back into your hands, right? Yeah. Time equals money.
My goodness, you make me feel old because now I realize that to do a wholesale deal, you're making $15,000, $20,000 on a flip. And I did literally, maybe not thousands, but hundreds of wholesale deals at $2,500 or $3,000 a piece back in the mid-90s to the early 2000s. It's amazing how far it's come. And it just shows you that real estate kind of has this upward to the right trajectory and truly is amazing wealth builder. So it's really cool. I've been out of the wholesale game mostly for a long time, but I would have loved to have had a transaction coordinator because we did it all. I mean, we would do 100 deals a year for a long time, and both when we were wholesalers and then when we were doing the flips, the true flips, we were always at around that 100 deal a year mark. So think about how much time I could have saved.
Yes.
Maybe I could have done 25 more deals a year because I'd have had the time to do that had a company like yours.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, it's funny when I heard you speaking earlier, I'm like, we have something in common. We like to get into the things that are really hard, right? Mm-hmm. The problem solving. And that's like what's really interesting because I like to like push back on like the attorneys, like, okay, no, we can make this happen. How can we make this happen?
Yeah.
Right? And it just fills me with like so much energy to do things like that.
Well, and you come from the Sub 2 group as well, right? Like,
yes.
So you get lots and lots of opportunity to push back on the people that are telling you that what you're doing isn't allowed, isn't legal, that you can't do it here. Oh, maybe you could do that in California, but you can't do that in Texas. And yeah. I'm sure that you're getting that kind of pushback on probably 80 or 90% of your deals, or at least until you've done deals with the people that you've trained. You mm-hmm. train the closing agents to do these deals, right?
Yeah. It's really fun, right? Because like, I feel like I'm educating people all the time. And that's where I found myself that I would be a really great transaction coordinator. You know, I had the organizational skills. I was in management for many years. And then this side of it where I love to teach people.
Yeah.
So I'm giving that opportunity to be able to speak with other real estate investors, real estate agents, attorneys, and say, hey, this is what we're doing. Let me walk you through it. Or new investors that are like, hey, I want to do this, but I'm not so sure how to do it. Like, can you guide me? I'm like, yeah, absolutely. Let's do it. Let's sit down. Yeah. Let's talk through it. And these are the things that you want to look out for. So I love that aspect of it, of just like really seeing how people grow, right? They'll start off as my client with like their very first deal, and then they're doing like, you know, 5-10 deals. I'm like, oh my God, I remember when, you know, when we did our first deal. Is so amazing.
Yeah, that's always fun. I've seen that for 25 years. There are some people that have come in and started doing things, and then they go way beyond me, and then I'm just there cheerleading on them on, saying, all right, that's tremendous, right? I love to see entrepreneurs kind of grow. And that's what you're describing there, is someone who comes in, never done it before. They do their first deal, and the next thing you know, they're doing a dozen deals a month. And that's what being a real estate investor can do for somebody who's out there, who's on the right. other side of the YouTube channel here, who's watching this content. They can grab that first deal with mm-hmm. very little know-how, right? Like, so you don't have to have a whole lot of experience or talent right. or anything. You got to have a lot of drive, and then you can meet the people and put the pieces together. Mm-hmm. So that's sort of your role then as this finish line transaction coordinator,
yes.
is to take somebody's contract. And I bet, tell me if I'm wrong, you get handed contracts from some people that just don't know what happens next, right? Like, so here, I got this.
What do I do next?
Now what?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, I hear that quite a bit. But you know what's funny too? I tell people, when you have a transaction coordinator on your team, it's like a level up, right? So like, you know, when you're dealing with sellers and they're like a little skeptical, oh, this investor's coming to me, like how legit are they, right? But when you're able to say, hey, my transaction coordinator is going to reach out to you to discuss next steps, now you just gave yourself that like level up, and they're like, oh, wait a minute, he has a team.
Yeah.
Okay. Or she, let me say, he or she has,
or
a,
she
team,
has a
right?
team,
right?
Yeah.
And it just gives them that extra level of professionalism. So they're not having to stumble through explaining what the next steps are.
And it gives them that authority in the, so let's say it's a buyer to a seller.
Right.
Now I come in and I've got a contract with the seller and I hand it off to my team. All of a sudden the seller's like, this guy or this girl's got their shit together.
Yes.
They're very professional. They've done this before. And even if I didn't know what I was doing and I've handed it off to you, you come in and answer all the questions for the guy.
Exactly.
And make the buyer look like a rock star.
Mm-hmm.
So what an awesome business.
Yes, I love it.
I love it. Coke, Jinx, you have a Coke. You owe me a Coke. How does that go?
Jinx, you owe me a soda.
I would love for you to show or tell the audience, you know, how do they get a hold of you and how can they use your services? And let's, guys, if you're out there and you're doing your first deal, or maybe you're doing your 1,000th deal and you didn't know about this transaction coordination mm-hmm. stuff, look her up, have a conversation with her, and see what you can do and where they
absolutely.
Can get a hold of you.
Absolutely. So really quick, I just want people to also know that you don't have to be a newbie, or you don't have to be extremely experienced to use a transaction coordinator. Like, we deal with investors from like very different backgrounds, different experiences. But, you know, for anybody that's looking to use our services, we always direct you guys to our website, which is FinishLineTC, that's T as in Tom, C as in Charlie, services.com. And you can also email me at Jennifer@ F as in Frank, L as in Larry, T as in Tom, C as in Charlie, services.com.
And we're not done, guys. I want to know about your business because we're pro entrepreneur here and you're relatively new, right? Like, yeah. I think a year and a half you've been doing this. How many transactions have you taken to the finish line?
Yeah. So year to date, we've done over 1,000 deals.
That's amazing.
Yeah. I have a team that works under me. I have three other partners, which you saw at the Creative Investors Network. I have 20 transaction coordinators that work under me. So we're able to handle.
This is a big business you've built in a year and a half.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So that didn't necessarily translate while I was watching your team. But what did translate was you had four people up on stage just taking questions, and it was like every question was a softball because whoever had the mic in their hand was just killing it, right? That was
thank you.
That was pretty impressive. Your entire team was able to stand in front of the room on the hot seat and just talk to a room full of potential investors, potential clients, and answer the questions in real time. And it felt authentic, and just you guys were all really, really good.
Yeah, we love talking to people. You know, that's one of the things where, like, sometimes people think, oh, I'm going to be a transaction coordinator because I want to be behind the scenes, but I don't want to talk to anybody.
Yeah.
And it's like, no, you still have to make connections. And this business, I tell people all the time, is relationship-based.
Yeah, I didn't get that you guys were four introverts. You seem to all be able to handle the room and work the crowd. And, yeah, so that's good. And so when you go to an event like your husband put on, or you come on a channel like this and we talk about your business, do you get direct business out of, let's just go back to the event that we did this week. How many people came up to you and asked for your card and are gonna now use your services?
Yeah, there were so many people going up to me and my partners and like saying, I didn't even know what a transaction coordinator was.
I was one.
Or like, yeah, I have this deal that I'm working on. It's like, great, let's talk about it. You know, let's set up a consultation. And literally consultations are like 10, 15 minutes. Let's just get an understanding of like what the deal is about.
Yeah.
But it's amazing because we really get to see people face to face rather than just like over the phone or on Zoom. So like we are building that rapport and that trust, just being able to be in the same room at the same time.
Yeah. And I asked the question with the next question in mind is that, or the statement is, when you can go to these events and you can network with people who are doing the business, it gives you opportunities to do more business, right? Like, so that's why I set it out there like that, is that I'm in the room with 40 people that I don't know and talked for 15 minutes up there. But now I've met 40 people that I didn't know that hopefully I can do business with. And 40 people came into that room can do business with you. Mm-hmm. So my point is, when you have the chance to go to these events, go to these events.
Definitely.
When you have the chance to network with people who are a little bit ahead of you, or maybe even people that you're all newbies and never done anything, get inside rooms where people are thinking like-minded, where people have the same sort of vision. Or and I don't think that everyone should have the same idea. And I'm certain that if you have a room of 3, 4, or 40 people, you won't have the same opinions. So you get to have healthy conversations. And what I saw this weekend is that even putting together a group of 40 or 50 people, lots and lots of business comes out of those kind of situations. So
absolutely,
I encourage everyone to go to the next
Creative Network Investors.
Yeah. So let's back up and go into like your origin story. How did you get the entrepreneurial bug and how many businesses have you started? You just kind of fill us in on where you've come from and where you're going with this entrepreneurial life.
Yeah. So for many years, I was in the healthcare field. Right. And I got to a point in my life where I was like, hey, I started as a CNA receptionist, medical assistant, worked all my way up to practice manager, right, of a general surgery practice. And
wow.
I built it up because when I started it there, there weren't a lot of medical assistants. I had to train them. I had to create training material. Like, it was a lot. Right. So I got it up to 30 people and, you know, trained different departments. It was great. But I'm like, OK, what else can I do? Right. And that's when we started to get into the real estate world. And then COVID hit. And honestly, that was like the thing that like changed everything. At that moment, I was like, I was kind of hurt because, you know, I had to make a decision. Either I get the booster vaccine while I was pregnant. There was no studies on it yet.
Oh, my.
Yep. or I lose my job. So I had to make that very hard decision.
That's a horrible decision to have to make.
Yeah. Yeah. It was really, really hard. But, you know, with faith, we're like, God is going to have us. We're going to figure it out. Everything's going to be good. So I started, you know, I had my baby. I decided I wasn't going to get the booster vaccine. And
good for you. Good for your baby.
I started working for an insurance company. And I'm like, great, I get to work from home. I get to stay with my baby. And I was learning what a transaction coordinator was at the same time. I was juggling both. Mm-hmm. I wish there was like a camera recording me the whole time, because like the stuff that I would do was just crazy. You know, I'm working my 9 to 5. Then I have another laptop, multitasking, handling clients, watching a newborn. Like,
Have a baby.
Everything, yeah. Like literally everything. But the entrepreneurial bug, I got that from my dad, because my dad was always into business. You know, he's been a barbershop owner for many years. He's juggled many businesses before. And I knew that I wanted to do something different. So, you know, I know you were speaking to my husband. We did have, you know, the trucking business.
Mm-hmm.
I ran that and I learned like so many things. And that right there gave me like the inspiration. I was like, I never knew anything about trucking before. Yet I was able to create this LLC, get it registered, like do everything. I'm like, if I can do that, I can do anything.
You're right.
I was like, man, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
So from there, like I got that inspiration. I'm like, okay, I can literally learn anything. So I learned the transaction coordinator stuff. And then honestly, I wasn't thinking like I'm going to have this big business, right? I was just thinking I'm going to do it to help my husband out and just do the thing. As I started to get busier and busier, I'm like, okay, well, I need some help. I need to hire somebody else. And that kept snowballing and snowballing until this big thing. And it's been amazing, honestly. Obviously, you know, it's not easy when you're starting a new business. Mm-hmm. You're learning, you're trying to figure out new things and making things better. But going back to something that you had mentioned before, where you said, you know, it's hard to give up control.
Yeah.
That's me.
For me.
That's me too.
That's us.
Yeah. That's me. And I knew that I needed help, but I'm like, I don't want to give it up. Like, And I had to take that step back and say, well, if I want to scale, I have to take a step back,
mm-hmm.
teach others so that I can keep growing my business.
Yeah.
So once I got over that hump, I was like, man, now we're doing 100 deals a month.
Yeah.
I'm not doing 100 deals myself,
but
because my team were able to juggle that much. So when people say, well, hey, I'm doing like 10 deals a week. Can you guys, like, how's your bandwidth? I'm like, just bring it over. Yeah. We could do it.
If we don't have the bandwidth for it, we'll hire someone new for you.
Exactly.
I mean, yeah. And so I'm just putting this together right now, but it seems like you started the business to be helpful with your husband's business and your sub-2 business buying properties. Mm-hmm. And what you've got now is probably, at least it sounds like, outgrown the actual real estate business, right? Like, so this is become a bigger baby for you than,
yeah.
I guess you're still buying sub-2 stuff, but
yep.
If you've got 30 employees and a few partners and stuff, and you're doing deals 50 states plus Puerto Rico, mm-hmm. this is no small business.
No.
This is no small business at all.
Yeah. And like, you know, you were mentioning before about, you know, you're working 60 hours a week, you know, and people are like, well, where's the work-life balance, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I look back at my W-2. And because I was a manager, I was salary. And I remember my boss telling me, well, you have to work later. And I had a hard time with that because I'm like, well, I have kids. I have to pick them up at the bus stop. My husband can't. And I thought to myself, I'm like, if I was able to put that much energy and time into a W-2 that didn't care about me, they were okay with replacing me.
Yeah.
Why can't I do that for myself? And that's, you know, I always see people and I'm like, hey, you have the potential. You have to get out of that W-2 mindset and just go for it, because no one's going to care about you like you care about yourself and your family. A job will replace you.
So this is a conversation that we're constantly having, because people get safety in the W-2. They think that there's some magical security there.
Mm-hmm.
And in my opinion, and the way that I kind of have always been naturally wired, I never found my security in that. And I was a bad employee, so I knew that I didn't have security there. So that made that easy. But even going back to childhood, I looked at my father, who was a go-to-work, worked for the same company for 30 years, you know, tried to get a pension and all that stuff. And at the end of his life, he gets hurt and they throw him out. Just like you said, like, there's no loyalty in that. And so if you're going to put in 50, 60 hours a week working for a salary, a W-2 job for someone else who will replace you in a second with a robot or with someone else who would do the job cheaper, why not do it for yourself? I think there's only security in that. And I say it on the channel, I like to look in the mirror and know that if things are going poorly, there's someone that I can blame. And he's looking right there at me, and I can say, yeah, okay, I messed that up. Or if things are going well, I can go, yeah, you did it. All right. So that's good. But I get my security, and I think most entrepreneurs do have that security in knowing that I'm gonna live or die by what I do. I'm going to eat or not eat by what I can do. My family is going to be okay or not okay, and I get to look myself in the mirror, and it's either that I did it or I didn't do it, and I don't have anybody else to blame. So I encourage people who are listening to your story, don't be afraid. If you've got an idea, you can do this, right? Like, you started a trucking business. That's amazing, right? Like, I couldn't run a trucking business. I wouldn't know where to start. And it sounds like you didn't know either when you were starting out.
Oh, no,
But you did it.
Yeah, I did it. And, you know, one thing that I love about real estate and, like, being a transaction coordinator is the flexibility. Mm-hmm. And I'll take that all day over a W-2 that wants to pay me $50 an hour. Like, I'll take flexibility over that all day long because I can pick up my kids whenever I want.
Yeah.
We go on vacations, bring my laptop, bring my phone, and I'm working, right? Yeah. And that doesn't stop my business from moving forward. Like, I can take clients everywhere. And I love the fact that I have so many options, right? We service all 50 states and Puerto Rico.
Yeah.
Like, there's no limit to that.
Yeah. And if you want to make more money, you can take on more clients. You can do more. I think of it in this light is like, for me to go to work for somebody, they'd have to pay me some stupid salary in order for, and I'd still hate it. Like, I think that someone could pay me $1 million a year to do a job, and I don't care what the job is. Mm-hmm. And that's a lot of money, right? Mm-hmm. Like, so I'd probably take the job. I know for sure that 6 months down the road, I would hate it. I would just be like, I'd rather go make less money and do it for myself and not be told.
And the fact that, like, you know, when you're like growing up, you have your parents telling you, you have to go to college. And if you want to be successful in life, you have to get a degree.
Yeah.
And that's the only way you're going to make a lot of money. And I realized that I actually was having that conversation with the oldest, the one that's here. And she, you know, she's looking at colleges and we're trying to figure out like what she wants to do. She doesn't really know. But I said, I'm like, I wish that someone would have told me you don't need to go to college to be very successful.
Yeah.
There are very successful people that don't have degrees.
Many, many.
Many.
Yeah, I imagine the truck drivers in your trucking business, they made a really good living, right?
Mm-hmm.
I know that. Right now, if you have a trade, if you are an electrician, a plumber, a carpenter, a welder, pick a trade, you get paid. Like, these jobs are amazing, and too many people have passed on them that they were handy with their hands, and they went to college because they believed that lie that you had to go do this, when they could have gone in, done an apprenticeship, learned the trade, been 4 years into the job. By the time their friends are graduating from college, they're all in debt, and these guys are making $100,000 a year, maybe, oh, by the way, starting their own business.
Yep.
Wow. Like, you do not have to go to college. You do not have to conform to the broken systems. I call them that all the time. Like,
oh, yes.
You just don't have to do it. I think college is sort of broken unless you're gonna be a doctor, a lawyer, an engineer. Why do you need to do that?
I mean,
my plumber gets paid more than my doctor.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure.
Oh, yes.
I'm pretty sure. Yeah. And so that's the truth of it, guys. You guys can do anything you've put your mind to. And so if you've got a brilliant idea, if you've got the idea that you want to be able to look yourself in the mirror and know that you live or die by what you eat what you kill, right? Like, that's this entrepreneur kind of spirit and mantra. If you feel that way, don't be afraid to jump in. Because even if you start a business that doesn't go well, you're an entrepreneur, you're a business owner, and then the next thing's going to go well for you. And if that one doesn't, you get up, you dust yourself off, and the next one. And eventually, you're going to find your niche, you're going to find your way, and you're going to make it. And you're going to have a business with 30 employees and you know that you started a year and a half ago and smiling like she's smiling the whole time.
You know what's the beauty of it is, you know, I look back and I'm like, man, we didn't give up.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't give up. And, you know, I'm very, very successful. And to, like, look back and see the growth is amazing. Because I tell people, I'm like, my very first consultation, I didn't know that much. And I had, on the consultation, it was like 3 or 4 investors. And they were just throwing questions at me. And I wanted to curl up in a ball and just, like, not do it. And now I'm, like, answering questions left and right. The amount of growth and to have investors say, thank you. Like, I would not have been able to get my first deal if it wasn't for your help.
Yeah.
Because sometimes they feel stuck. It's like, okay, I got this deal, but what do I do now?
Yeah.
Where I don't even know who to contact, because you can't just contact any attorney.
Right.
You can't just contact any title
especially
company.
In your business where you cater to the sub two or the seller finance. A lot of the kind of standard closing agents or attorneys, they just don't know how to do that. So they'll tell you that you can't do it.
Right.
And you'll be told, no, this is wrong. So you'll have your first deal and it's the deal of a lifetime and you take it to the wrong person to close it and they kill your deal.
Falls apart.
Which, by the way, we could have a whole video on how bringing a lawyer to the table will destroy a deal. So just know that you don't need them. And so, I mean, really though, you are doing this in the hardest environment, which I admire very much. And we talked about
Thank you.
Like, I like the fact that you find, where's the hardest place for me to be a transaction coordinator? Oh, it's this place where I'm going to be told that I can't do it. And so then you're creating the pathway for people to do this kind of real estate transaction.
It's amazing. And like here in Puerto Rico, I remember, like, you know, my husband started Sub 2 Borinking and people wanted to do transactions, like creative transactions here, but they're like, well, who do I reach out to? How do we do this? And it took us getting a deal from a wholesaler that didn't know where else to go with it. Like, he didn't have any connections to attorneys or anything like that. But he reached out to Irving and he's like, hey, I have this deal. I know you guys want to, you know, move to Puerto Rico at some point. You want it? And it started there. I'm like, oh, yes. I get to TC this deal in Puerto Rico, and no TC within Sub 2 has TC'd in Puerto Rico.
Nice.
And like that concept is still like kind of new here.
Yeah.
Like, talk to the attorney and he's like, well, what exactly do you do? Like, you know, and I just explained to him, like, I'm just going to be facilitating. I'm just going to help, you know, gather things, just communicate with everyone, just making sure that this turns out to be what was intended to be, right? A creative deal. And I did it. And once I was able to do it, I'm like, I can do this. This is so cool.
Yeah. And you're opening doors for a whole industry here.
Oh, yes.
I know 6.5 years ago when I got here and was talking to people about buying, and I don't even know if I knew the term sub two, but buying and assuming people's mortgages, I was flat out told, we don't do that here. Seller financing, that doesn't happen here.
Mm-hmm.
Wholesaling, no, we don't do that here.
Yeah.
Like you want to come to the land of no, that's,
right.
6.5 years ago, Puerto Rico was the land of no. And now with your husband's group, the Sub 2 group, with your services and people just trying to kick those doors open and get it open and do these kind of transactions. Mm-hmm. Now we're seeing it. We're seeing it a lot. Like, I would say more than half of the offers that I make on the island right now are seller finance. Not so much Sub 2, but a lot of seller finance stuff where that was, they wouldn't even take those offers 6.5 years ago. It was like, oh, you don't have cash and you can't go to the bank? No.
Right. You know what's funny, though? Because I think the word sub two sometimes scares people, right? Because they're like, what is that? Yeah. I don't know that concept. But they don't know that this has been going on for many, many years, right? Especially here in Puerto Rico. People would say, hey, I can't take care of my house anymore. I'm going back to the States. Hey, son, do you want to just take over my mortgage?
Yeah.
Just keep paying the house. Take care of it and I'll go.
Right.
That's the same concept.
Yeah.
Right. But no one ever like really thought into it. And now, okay, now you have an attorney that's going to put everything, you know, in legal terms. But it's been happening.
Yeah. Do you know that until this weekend at the conference, like, I didn't know that you could get title insurance on a sub two deal. Like, I've done dozens of them. And I just buy them and start making the payments. No transaction coordinator, nothing. I just step in and do it all myself. and take the risk, the full on, like if the bank comes and calls it due, then I'm going to go find the money. And thank God I haven't ever had anything called due, but there is a whole, because I think it's being popularized right now because of interest rates and because of where we're at in this real estate market, you guys are trailblazers, like setting it up so that a title insurance thing is possible. Like, wow, yes. That's very cool. The other thing is setting up so that you can have automatic payments made and you can tell mm-hmm. the seller, look, you don't have to take my word for it.
Right.
Look here, it's going to be there every month. You'll see automatically that the payment is being made. For me, when I was doing it starting back in like 1997, it was like, listen, you're in foreclosure. You're going to lose your house anyways. What do you have to lose, right? I'm going to make your payments or I'm not. And you're in the same place, except I'm going to give you some cash. So it's really come a long way. This whole industry has really kind of become legitimized, and it's truly a great way to get into the real estate game. So you can do the TC stuff for more than just real estate. It doesn't have to be a sub two deal. You can buy a car with it. Someone can, you could help them with anything.
Yeah, there's so many different things, and this is what I love, right? When it comes to being a transaction coordinator, there are so many things you can help out with, right? So you can sub two vehicles, right? A transaction coordinator can come in and assist with that. But for somebody that's selling a business, we can help with that as well. We don't just work with investors, right? We also work with real estate agents.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very common for real estate agents to use transaction coordinators because it facilitates things for them and it makes the process a lot easier. So transaction coordinators can help in any of those things, as well as once the deal closes, we can help facilitate like setting up utilities, making sure that all the paperwork gets sent to the mortgage company, the insurance, and you know, everything is set up literally for you to just go.
Yeah. So what if I'm watching this for some reason and I'm not a real estate investor, but I want to buy a house and I want to do it maybe sub two. Can they just reach out to you and then you could hook them up with wholesalers, right? Like I would imagine that could become a part of your business once word gets out there enough that you know the people in the know that are doing the deals. And if I'm in New York State and I want to buy a house and I don't want to pay 9% interest, I want to take over someone's mortgage that was 3%. And they've had it in place for 4 or 5 years, you could make those connections for people.
I'm glad you actually brought that up because we're like the hub, right? We deal with private money lenders.
Yes.
We deal with buyers and sellers and real estate agents. We have all of these connections. And so it's very easy for us to connect people with one another and say, hey, you know, I have this private money lender. I actually connected my husband with another private money lender. And I said, hey, the guy reached out to me. He's like, hey, I want to get into some deals. I don't really know, but I have some money. So what can I do? And I'm like, I can connect you with someone.
Yeah. Okay. So now you know, you can reach out to Jennifer and you can become a hard money lender. You can become a homeowner. You can become a wholesaler. She can make connections for you. And by the way, she'll take your first deal to the finish line and then all the deals after that. That's really impressive. That's awesome.
So I just want to say thank you so much for, you know, having me here on your YouTube. It was amazing. And it was a pleasure meeting you and all the great things that you're doing here on the island. And I hope to, you know, do business with you one day.
Well, we will do business. I mean, that's our invitation to people. We like to partner with people and we like to expand our business through partnerships. So I love that. I think we'll have plenty of opportunity to do business. I'm going to be, you know, singing your praises and sending you people. And so hopefully very soon we can buy a piece of real estate together, maybe do a sub two deal. Who knows where it'll go?
I would love that.
We'll do another conference. Let's figure that out. And thank you so much for coming in and sitting down and talking to us. Thank you guys for watching the video and appreciate you guys already hitting that thumbs up, but hit it again, hit it at least a couple more times. So, all right, guys, thanks for watching. God bless.